Welcome, friends, to this second day, the afternoon session of our 3 days, 4 days celebration for Bhandara. I'm very happy to welcome you again. When I come and greet you, it's a good feeling I get. At my age, you all look like my children. So if I sometimes have a little fatherly style of talking to you, please forgive me. I'll answer a few questions that have been sent up, and I think Jonathan has written questions. We'll read up a few.
Can you please explain in detail how one can develop love and devotion?
Can you please explain in detail how one can develop love and devotion? The detailed answer is, you cannot. Love and devotion cannot be developed. All things that we develop are developed by the mind. Love and devotion is not a mental process at all. Love and devotion happens when we are experiencing love. We become devoted automatically. It's the power of love that pulls us and makes us devoted. It's amazing how love operates. We have had experiences, all of us, falling in love instantaneously. When you fall in love with somebody or you experience the love, do you fall in love? Or do you experience love? That's a question. Is there a passive and active role in this, in love? When you fall in love, somebody has pulled you. A Persian Farsi mystic has said, Ishq awwal dardile mashuk paida mishwar, which means love is first born in the heart of the beloved. The lover is not the creator of love. The beloved is. Is the lover then a lover or a devotee? You can't distinguish the two. Because love is a strange experience. It pulls you, and at the same time, you become a devotee. And the one that you think is the beloved is the lover who pulled you. So it's a very simultaneous process. Cannot be developed, but comes automatically. That devotion that comes by experience of love is the only true devotion. If you're trying to develop something, it's a mental exercise. People try to develop love and devotion, and then they get caught up into the mind's games. And most of the time, when people are trying to develop love and devotion, more doubts and more mental hurdles come in the way. Don't try to develop love and devotion. Experience the love, and devotion will come automatically to you. Any other question?
Many. Many. When we start listening to the sound, does it become louder?
When we start listening to the sound, does it become louder? Yes, it does. It depends on which sound we are talking of. When we do the meditation of the sound, which means listening to the sound of ourself, not listening to any sound, listening to the sound of ourself, which is distinguished from all other sounds. We can hear sounds of outside sounds we are hearing now. Varanatmak shabd, spoken words are also sound. You are listening to me right now. I am listening to you. I just listened to Jonathan reading the question. The power of listening does not belong to the ears. It belongs to the soul. We will keep on listening all the time, even when there is no space or time to listen. Listening is a very powerful thing. If you ask me a secret thing about how one can have the best meditation, how can one become an expert in meditation, my simple answer will be, become a good listener, the best listener you can be. Listen to everything with attention, because when you start listening, the capacity to listen increases. You are also then capable of listening to your own self in meditation. When we do meditation and want to listen, and we don't have enough practice, the first practice is that when we are repeating words of the mantra or simran we have been given by a master, and that's one purpose of giving word to repeat with the mind, not with the tongue. People who sing loudly, chant loudly with the tongue are not pulling their attention inside at all. They may get peace of mind. They may enjoy the song. They may enjoy the words, but that is not an exercise for pulling attention inside. Only when you listen with and speak with the mind and listen with the soul, your attention is pulled in. What does it mean, speaking with the mind and not with the tongue? It means that you have to replace thoughts. When you think, your tongue doesn't move. Words are still there in your head. Those words that are in your head are the words of thought. You listen to those thoughts. You listen to those words, but no tongue is involved. When we try to repeat words taught to us, you will notice that we try to speak with our tongue. Sometimes when we try very hard to start speaking with our mind, tongue still moves a little bit. It takes a while to only speak with the mind and listen. That's the proper listening even of the words. Speaking with the tongue does not have any real value in real meditation. Our Saint Kabir has said, Mala to karme phire, jeev phire mukh mahe, manwa to chahu dish phire, ye to simran nahi. If you are holding the beads in your hand and moving them, tongue is repeating the words of mantra, mind is roaming around all over the world, this is not called simran. Don't think you are doing simran at all. That is why there is a stage by which we go and become proper listeners of the sound within. Listening outside, we become listeners. Listening with attention makes us better listeners. Then when we close our eyes and we don't hear any sounds, we generate the sound of repetition of the words. Repetition of words helps us in many ways, including the fact that we become good listeners. So when we start listening to the words, the sounds come automatic. If we merely repeat the word, sound does not come. If we listen to the word, sound comes. It's the listening capacity that has to be awakened and developed. That happens automatically when you are putting attention on listening. Listen very attentively. And what are the parameters for doing that? One, do not repeat too fast. Rapid repetition of any kind of mantra is like a parrot repeating it. No value. Very slowly. Because when you repeat slowly, you can listen to every part of every word. Then, if the word has more than one syllable, listen to each syllable. That means you are involved. Your attention is involved in listening. You become good listeners. If you do that, I can assure you, you will be able to listen other sounds in the head automatically. People have said, we have been meditating for a long time, never heard any sound. Well, you didn't develop listening. You are trying to listen to something with your mind speaking and your mind is somewhere else. You're thinking of something else. That's not listening. Put attention on the words and become listeners. When that happens, different sounds can be heard, which are not coming through the ears. They are internal sounds. But those sounds come from various directions. Sometimes looks like sound is coming from the right side, some sounds are coming from the left side, and you are trying to listen, which one should I listen? So, say, Master say, you should listen on the right side. That is, they are speaking. Don't listen to the left side. That's Karl speaking. I've heard people explain this to me. I think all outside sound, whether right or left, are Karl speaking. Dhyal speaks from the center. Dhyal speaks where he sits in our soul. Not in the body, not in the ears, not on the sides. But when you are listening, to practice listening, listening to wherever the sound comes from, just to practice. These are practice sounds that come from the sides. And they can be very different kinds of sounds. The sounds can be like whistle, blowing of whistles. Sound can be when a train comes to a covered platform of a station, there is an echo of it. That echo comes inside. There are sometimes like chirping of birds. The birds are chirping. Sometimes the crickets are chirping. Sometimes little bells are ringing. All kinds of sounds, like thunder sometimes, drums beating. People have heard different kinds of sounds. They are all being generated within the system, most of them with physical reasons of the anatomy of the body. But some of them are coming even from the astral sensory self. We don't know which ones are those, but they are not the sounds of the self. The sounds of the self are from the center of the head. They can look like they are behind the eyes and above the eyes. Why? Because when we have our astral self inside, which means when we imagine we are sitting inside the head, we start imagining, but we still have the same vertical shape that we have outside. So the imagination brings us to the same vertical shape inside. Even when we say we want to sit behind the eyes, we don't reduce ourselves to a dot. We are still the same. And therefore, our self feels like it is sitting in the center, behind the eyes and upwards, like this. Therefore, the sound that starts coming from here is not easily heard because we are so much used to listening with ears. So we are constantly listening from the sides. But the listening from the ear will come when we try to put our attention on the center. That means, don't move towards any sound. When you try to catch a sound, the attention moves that way, then you don't hear the sound from the center. You move right or left. Why the masters have recommended that if you hear sound from both sides, listen to the right, is simply the functioning of our brain is such that one side is more intuitive, other side is more rational. Intuitive power comes from the soul, rational power comes from the mind. Therefore, they have suggested, if the sound comes from both sides, prefer the right. It's merely a suggestion. It does not make the sound right. I have met my friends who spent 20 years listening to the sound from the right, and that's all they got, listening sound from the right. I said, did you see anything? Did you feel that you are vacating the body and going somewhere? No. But I am listening to the sound. But that is not the objective of meditation, to just listen to the sound. Objective is to withdraw your attention to yourself. Therefore, what actually happens, these sounds, when you listen to them, naturally you put attention, they become louder. Any sound can become louder. Even outside sounds. You go to an orchestra, and there are some different musical instruments playing. You like the drums more. Put your attention on the drums. Drums will become louder. The others will become dimmer. Nothing has changed there. Your attention can make anything louder. Similarly, the sounds inside, when you put attention, become louder. The sound of the self, which we do not come to because we are used to listening to the ear and are scattered all over, takes time. And to start with is a very dim, feeble sound at a distance. it looks like far away something resembling a bell sound. Oh, oh, far away. So when you say far away, then you play a game of shifting your attention from one sound to another. Play with the sounds. Now you can play with this sound, now with that one, now in this near one, now farther one. If you do that, don't stick to what is happening and just sit there. You play with your attention. You put your attention on the weak sound coming from far. And that weak sound also starts becoming louder with your attention. Ultimately, it becomes the loudest sound, and other sounds are becoming so dim, you don't even hear them. This sound, to start with, is like the ringing of a big bell. These bells ring, dong, 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 with that, all that beat in it. As you listen to it and become louder, the dong increases in length. Dong. They were shorter, become longer. Ultimately, it only becomes one long peal. And there is no beat in it. At that stage, you will find that you are being pulled completely by the sound very rapidly. It's the fastest way to pull your attention from the physical to the astral. And I don't recommend that. I don't recommend that you should listen at that rate that you are suddenly pulled, because it frightens. It frightens us, because experience is like dying. I remember my own dad telling me, he was also initiated by a great master, and he was very keen on it, and he practiced meditation rather seriously and too much. So when he heard the sound, and the sound pulled him, he was almost being pulled out of his body. And he said, I'm dying. What kind of meditation has this master taught me? He said, never again, never again. I'm not going to commit suicide. And this is a way to commit suicide, what he told me. And he stopped meditation and went back and told the great master, Master, what you taught me is killing myself. That's not the spiritual way I thought you'd be teaching me. Great master said, let me tell you some statistical fact. People can die anytime. People can die while having a cup of tea. People have been talking in the middle of the talk, they have dropped dead. Isn't it strange that nobody has ever died, ever, while hearing the sound inside? Why are you afraid? Doesn't the statistics help you that nobody ever died and you will not die? He said, I am still afraid. He said, okay, supposing you die, what do you expect? He said, I hope you will be there. He said, I will certainly be there. That's our deal in initiation. Then he said, take it easy. You don't have to rush through this process. Don't forget, this moment in your life has not come at a particular time in this life. It has come after several thousand lives. You have spent millions of years already before you got this opportunity. So there's no rush about it. It takes a year, takes 2 years, takes 5 years, takes a lifetime. It's very fast. Don't worry about it. But go, what he called in his words, darja by darja, stage by stage, step by step, slowly. If you hear the sound, you pulled a little, good. Next day, little more. Then third day, little more. There is no fear. Then you realize what is happening. And you get accustomed to it. We can adapt to anything. So this adaptation is necessary if you are listening to the sound. But certainly, what makes the sound loud is your attention on it. And when you place attention on the inner sound, it will become loud.
Why does the soul need to have physical experience?
Why soul needs to have physical experience? Why do we go to movies? We don't need to. Why do we love movies? Why do we love drama? It is a natural thing for consciousness to be conscious of something. It's a natural thing, the nature of consciousness. It's not nature of you, me, soul or anybody. Nature of our totality, that consciousness has to be conscious to exist. Its existence, to call it consciousness means it is conscious of something. And that something is called creation. Therefore, it's not that once upon a time there was a creator sitting alone. He said, now let me create. That's not the truth. The truth is the creator, creation are a continuous thing. The creator, creation. If we understand that the creator is consciousness, then consciousness and that to be conscious of existed simultaneously all the time. So that is why to be conscious of something, that means to be creative is natural to consciousness. All levels of experiences, not necessarily physical. There are so many experiences, amazing experiences. The first experience, which is automatic and generated by consciousness, is the experience of the one and the many in one. Difficult to understand here, but it's an experience in our true home, in totality. Total consciousness is consciousness and units of consciousness inside. The units of consciousness we call souls, and consciousness we call creator. What was the need for consciousness to have the many to start with? Physical comes much later. The need was to make its true nature, the true nature of consciousness per se, was love, total knowledge, total bliss, true nature. If that were not the true nature of consciousness, I would not be interested in going to totality. The true nature is so beautiful. The total love, total bliss, total awareness, total knowledge. That's big, big goal. It appeals to my consciousness here. Therefore, we set our goal on our true home based upon the nature of our totality. Now, if the nature of totality is, say, love, it does not make it an experience of love. It is love. When you have the many, it becomes an experience of love. People become lovers and beloveds, as souls, as units. Within totality, you can experience so much love. Experience. The experience is not generated till the many is created. People ask, why were many souls created? That's the reason. The many has made something that was innate in consciousness into an experience. Once that has happened, it can be expanded further. The expansion of experience, the word expansion I am using, is itself, as we understand it, expansion into space and time. That's the biggest expansion that can take place. So, a little equipment we add to ourselves by creating it, called the human mind, or mind itself, or universal mind. A machine that can generate and make the illusion of time and space into real experience. It's a wonderful thing. The many who are in totality now experience an expansion of experience through the mind. That's a beautiful, wonderful opportunity to go so vast that we can go wherever we like. And what? How do we experience? How do we experience? Consciousness can experience in many ways. How does it experience? The first experience of love is completely indescribable. It's a great pull. Pull that holds you together and also keeps you separate at the same time. Beautiful. How does it work when time and space are created? It still pulls us within that. Everything pulls each other. Everything, objects, people, animals, everything created is attracting each other. People are trying to understand gravity. They haven't understood. If they go there, they'll understand gravity is just the pull at the mental state first created. that universal mind. When you see that universal mind copies, it's creative as something to work in now, time and space. It works the same principle as the original totality. Totality individuated itself to make souls. The mind individuates itself to make individual minds. So the experiences, mental experiences, become many because of the many minds. Great development, greater experience. Perception is being done through the mind. Consciousness is conscious through time and space, through the mind, and is perceiving what is creating. Wonderful. It's a great experience. To enlarge experience further, perception, which is experience of what has been created, divided. Divided into sense perceptions. That means separate seeing from hearing. It wasn't there before. At the mental level is one perception. Mind perceives total. But the sense perceptions divided. Very useful for making the experience into a reality. Because by sense perceptions, we can then use these different sense perceptions to touch, to see, and say it's real. And cut off the remaining experience, how we generated it. Cut off our experience of our origin. Cut off all the knowledge and just make this. What a beautiful reality we create out of consciousness. That consciousness can create a reality so beautifully and divide it into sense perceptions. It's a remarkable thing. We can fly, we have perceptions in the sky, we can go where we like, we can see what we like. To congeal this experience, as it were, we come up with a physical level of experience where it looks like these powers of perception are now working through an individuated physical being, like this human body we are having. It's the process that has come down to this level, that we can now experience the reality in this level. How many levels we've come down in order to become human beings? Should we keep on going further? Should we now develop more dreamlike states, go another 6-7 levels? We could have. And perhaps we have. Right now, we are at that physical level. At some point, we must develop means to go back if we like. After all, we are generating an experience and moving away from our origin and generating experience of duality. That means pairs of opposites, pain and pleasure, happiness, unhappiness, light and sound, light and darkness, sound and quiet. We are developing everything in pairs of opposites. Matter and antimatter. Everything has opposites today in physical plane. So therefore, when this is developed, we must have some arrangement. We can't go on hiding ourselves so far. We can't lock ourselves completely out of our own true home and leave the key inside. At least we should have the key with us to go back if we like. We were super intelligent enough at all levels to keep the key with us. But we allowed the key to work at a certain point in this devolution of experiences, and that happened to be the physical human level. It could be any level. Our decision. The totality of consciousness decided that the level at which we can apply the key to go back into our home should be at the physical human level. It did not say physical level. Because physical level, you can have animals and insects and birds and all forms of life around us. Lot of life around us. But a small part of that life, which we call human life, we place the key to go back here. To work the key, that it does actually work in the lock, a unique method was invented, beautiful method, and that was to give us the experience as if we have free will, that we can make a decision. Not that we are born and we just drift and we live, like all other life forms are living. There are trees outside, they are born, they grow, they die. Insects are born, grow and die. Birds are born, grow and die. Animals are born, grow and die. Angels are born and grow and die, if you go and see them. So-called gods that are running the universes are born, grow and die. Human beings don't. Human beings say, should I do it or not? Should I die or not die? Should I live or not live? Should I do this or not that? This element of choice given to a human being was a remarkable discovery, remarkable invention, I call it, that you could have an experience of free will as if you are the decision maker, whereas you are not the decision maker at this level at all. If the life has been set for all forms of life in advance, it's also set for us. From birth to death, our life is predicted. I have met many people in my life who made great predictions about what will happen, and it happened. How could they make a prediction if the thing that they say will happen has not already happened? It's not that they are creating the new condition, they are able to see it. There was a Swami in India, and he used to have visions. And the visions were always correct. But he had no control over the visions. I had many meetings with Swami. And he said he has no control, but the visions come and he can see things. Amongst many visions, he predicted that a South Indian person will become the Prime Minister of India when the Swami was only a young boy in a village in Rajasthan, and Narasimha Rao was the person whom he told, and he became Prime Minister, which was unexpected. All Prime Ministers were from North India. But he had a vision that this man who's come to see him is sitting in the Prime Minister's chair. This Swami became a friend of mine. I used to talk to him. When Gore and George Bush were fighting in the United States for presidentship, and Gore was leading in votes, I said, who will become president? He said, I had a vision. George Bush will be your president. And I said, are you sure? He said, I've seen him at his, that's the word Swami used. I have seen him at his coronation. There's no coronation in America. I said, Swami doesn't know about it. He said, I have seen him in his coronation. Later on, the whole tribe was left to Florida votes. And Florida, when the vote had, the Florida Supreme Court ruled Gore to be the winner. I called the Swami. I was in America. I called the Swami in India. I said, Swamiji, wrong this time. This time Gore is leading. He said, George Bush is the president. I've seen him at his coronation. The Supreme Court of the country, by vote of 5-4, declared George Bush to be the president with a minority vote in the country. The Swami was right. George Bush appointed Dick Cheney as his transition officer and vice president. And I heard Dick Cheney as transition officer explaining the arrangements made for the inauguration. And he said, and thousands of people heard him say, we will have the coronation on that date. Use the word coronation. How does the Swami know? If this thing has not already happened, the Swami can't know it. There was a lady I met at Spiritual Frontiers Fellowship. Early on, maybe many years ago, she lived in a town called DeKalb in Illinois. And from birth, she used to have dreams of something that will happen later. And things would generally happen after a week. So she began to write a journal of her dreams. Every time she had a dream, she would write it down. and after a week, 10 days, 15 days, things would happen. And she would mark them, this actually happened. And she was very right, and she couldn't explain where is this coming from. It's a dream-like state. When she met me at the Spiritual Frontiers Fellowship meeting, with I had giving a talk, she was also giving a talk. She was impressed by my telling that these things are fixed and they are all predetermined, that is why how you can see them. So she realized that's what she was doing, became a friend. And she said, I want to come and spend some time with you. I said, I am an immigrant, I had just come from India, but I am working with two friends of mine who have given me a small job, and we have a small office. If you don't mind, you can come and meet me in my office in Chicago area. And she said, certainly I'll come. So we decided that on a certain date, she will come to see me. 1 week before she was to see me, she had a dream. She had a dream that she was sitting in the lobby of a 5-star hotel, and a stretch limousine, big black stretch limousine comes, and I get out of it. And I greet her. She said, this little immigrant fellow, how can he get out of a stretch limousine? This time I might be wrong. Even she thought so. But she's seen me, poor fellow, coming from India and giving a talk in one meeting. And people are trying to support me. How can we take care of this little fellow come from India after retirement from jobs? So she said, this time I could be wrong. But she recorded the dream in the journal. One day before she was to come, my partners in business told her, we are not going to meet in the office. We will meet in that 5-star hotel, which she has seen the dream, which surprised her. She went to the hotel and waited in the lobby. And few days before she came, my partners and I, we had made good money selling cookies, but healthy cookies. They sold well. She was surprised when we came up in the station limousine. I got out. As soon as I get out, she walked to me with a journal in her hand. This is my dream. And she had recorded it 1 week earlier. I can tell you so many situations, so many people have had these experiences of being able to see the future, sometimes just a glimpse of it. During my service, at one time, I was in charge of a district as a district collector, deputy commissioner, they used to call it, in Kangra district, headquarters, Dharamsala, where I had a chance to receive the Dalai Lama also. And I heard that a few miles down from Dharamsala lives a famous astrologer whose name is Vidhu Vidya, but since he lives in a town called Gagal, he's called Gagal Jyotshi, the Gagal astrologer. And my predecessors always had to leave some notes for the future administrators to come and read how to administer the district. When I was reading the notes of one older British officer recorded in the journal in my office, he said, there is a man named Gagal Jyotshi, Gagal astrologer. You should go and see him because he can tell you the future. He can tell you anything. A British officer writing this. And he recorded something so interesting. He said, I informed the commissioner of the division about this man. The commissioner could not believe that any man can tell you what's happening anywhere in the world and what will happen in the future. Therefore, commissioner said, I'd like to see him. And this is a recording in the journal. The commissioner invited, he was so convinced, he said, we should let the Governor General and Viceroy of the country know it. There is a man like this available. So they informed the then Viceroy of India, the Governor General, a British guy, that we have a strange man here who can tell you anything. He has a way of reciting some shlokas in Sanskrit. When he recites them, his mind goes somewhere else and he can speak up things that you can never imagine. The Governor General said, bring him over. And they took him to New Delhi. This Gagal Jyotshi went to New Delhi and met the Viceroy. Viceroy said, what can you tell me? And he was trying to recite those shlokas and said, Viceroy, you have three brothers in London right now. Is that right? He said, anybody can read my biography. It's not a big deal you are telling me. Tell me something that nobody knows. And he recited those words, and suddenly in a trance-like state, he said, your wife, a Viceroy, is right now cutting an apple in the house. This was a little surprise. And the Viceroy called his house. Honey, what are you doing right now? I'm just having some fruit. What fruit are you having? Are you cutting some fruit? Yes, I'm cutting an apple. This is all recorded in the journal of the collector's office, deputy commissioner's office in Kangra. I read it. I was very impressed. I would like to see that guy also. I had a plan to go and see my commissioner, who was in a town called Jalandhar, in one side. Just as I packed up my jeep and loaded my luggage, and my wife said, I'll also come along with you. I said, okay, you come. I got a call from the commissioner. He's not available. He has to go somewhere. Cancelled. Meeting cancelled. I'd already packed up everything. I said, okay, to the driver. Okay, no Jalandhar. We are going to go to Palampur and I'll make a visit somewhere else. Another direction altogether. And I said, I'll stop with that Gagal Jyotshi on the way, that astrologer. I went there. And he was reciting those verses. And he said, you came to go in one direction, going in the other. I said, this guy knows something. Very impressive. My wife was also impressed. She told her father, there is a man like this who can tell things. He said, I don't believe it. The father is also a disciple of great master, initiated by him. He says, we are satsangis. We know this is not the right thing to do, even if he's doing it. These are riddhis and siddhis. People can control through yogic practices these powers, psychic powers called riddhis and siddhis. This man has controlled some riddhis and siddhis. And nothing to worry. We are not into that. These are lower chakras. We are to higher up. But he came to visit me. And I said, would you like to meet that guy? He said, the guy who has controlled his riddhis and siddhis? Okay, let's go. I drove to Gagal Jyotshi with my wife and a couple of other friends also. And when we went there, he was reciting the shlokas with his eyes closed. In the middle of the shlokas, when we were sitting, they made us sit there waiting for him to wake up from his trance. While repeating the shlokas, he said, okay, you think I am controlling riddhis and siddhis. Have you controlled your wife? My father-in-law was so alarmed. And he began to repeat. He said, this may be negative power. He began to repeat the five words given by grandfather. And that man in his stage began to repeat the five words. You think these five words are going to change it? Amazing experience. And then after a while, he opened his eyes. Oh, you are here. Welcome. I said, how did you know five words? He said, what five words? He had no idea whatsoever. He had no idea what he said. He had no idea he could predict these things. Therefore, the point we made is, if these things were not already there, you couldn't speak about it. Nobody could. If it was really totally free will, we would decide the future, and future cannot be predicted. The future has been predicted again and again. Therefore, there is no real free will in the sense that you are actually making a choice. But the experience of free will is real. How is it enforced? By ignorance. Ignorance of the future. Simple device. Here, human beings are blessed to have the key by which they can open the door to their true home, and they have to be given a device of free will. And free will cannot be generated when the whole thing is already created. Therefore, make them ignorant of the future and they will feel they have real free will. That's how free will operates here. But it's very useful. It is the key. If we did not have free will, we could never seek anything. The seeking comes from free will. Should I not? Am I right in doing it or not? These things happen along with our mind. Mind is searching for answers. Soul is seeking for the truth. Soul is always seeking for going back when we are ready for it. If we are not ready, we are enjoying the experience, lifetime after lifetime. When we are ready, the soul uses this key of seeking. When it seeks, if it seeks its true home, a perfect living master appears in the life of that human being. It's as simple as that. Very good, well pre-arranged method to open the lock and go back home. A great device made at this sixth physical level. Good level, could be made anywhere, but I am only telling you the pattern which has been developed so beautifully. It's the most beautiful structure that you can see, what you call creation. It's perfect. If you look at part of it, it's imperfect. If you see totality of creation, it's perfect. That is why perfection can only be seen from totality, not from part of it. Whenever we come into divided areas, a division was necessary to create the many. When we divide, then perfection goes away and we look at the analytical side and can't see the whole imperfect. When we say that master is perfect living master, the word perfect is used in that sense, that he has experience above the mind into perfection. And therefore, he's perfect in awareness. He's living as a human being, like us. Master, because he has come to take us back home. Period. But why is it necessary to have a living master there? What about a perfect master who's passed away, died, but left a message for us? Okay, you can believe me, you can follow me, now I'll help you. Let me make this very clear. Except for a living person who comes into our life. Anything else that we assume, either a dead master or other higher power, ascended master sitting in Tibet or mountains, or birds or natural creatures, or angels or gods, are all concoctions of the mind, all made up by your mind. There's no other way to make them up. That is why when we say, I am following a master who's passed away, you are following the mind. When a person says, I follow nature, you're following the mind. Somebody says, I follow God that I worship, you're following the mind. These are all mental creations which we create. A living person can tell us, no, these gods, these angels, these masters never tell us that. Never tell us no. Living person tells us, no, we are living people. Therefore, the arrangement to get back has been made in such a way that a living person comes in our life, ascended with knowledge, with awareness, and works while he's alive. Therefore, masters have themselves said that you need a living master to get this key to work, to go back to your true home. We have heard of Sheikh Farid, a perfect master. Sheikh Farid is mentioned several times in Sri Guru Granth Sahib, the holy book of the Sikhs. They didn't say that he was a Muslim or Hindu, he's a Muslim. So what? He was a master, perfect master, living master. His master's name was Qutbuddin, Sheikh Qutbuddin. And Farid would tell his son, "Son, Qutbuddin is getting old. Please get initiated from him and save your soul. Help yourself." And the son would say, "Dad, I am still young. I have to look at life and I'm running around. Please, when time comes, I will get initiated." And Farid would tell him again and again, "Son, master is getting old. Please get initiated while he's alive." And he would put it off. One day, Qutbuddin died. Sheikh Qutbuddin died, and his body is lying there before their burial can take place. And the son heard that Qutbuddin, the Sheikh, had died. He ran and shaved his head, which used to be customary for getting initiation from a master. And he put his head, shaven head, on the feet of the dead body of Qutbuddin. Said, "Initiate me." And standing there, his father, Farid, who had been asked by Qutbuddin to continue his work, he says, "My son, this is not the master. This is the body of the master. A perfect living master is one who can hold your hand. That Sheikh alone can help you. Who will hold your hand when he's alive and tell you, even 1 second later is no good." He made it clear. It has been explained so many times. As human beings, we want to open the key to the highest level of consciousness. Another human being appears with that level. The rest is all our mind. Our mind is very creative, very active, and can make up all kinds of things. And we develop religions based upon masters who have gone away. We develop institutions based upon masters gone away and think something will happen. Very often they become into business houses, more interested in collection than donation than money, more than spirituality. Spirituality disappears. Outside constructions of buildings, outside things continue to happen more. So this is something very important to know. Why we say perfect living master? A perfect living master is a necessity if you want to open the key to your totality. But if you want to hear some nice discourses and some nice lectures and get peace of mind, you can go to anybody. That's a different matter altogether. But it's a very important point. The need, you should examine why it's necessary. Only human being who is like yourself can guide you. If he's not like you, even then he can't guide you. If he's too far removed from you in terms of not being human, superhuman, he can't guide you. He has to be at the same level. It's remarkable how when these masters have come, how they have adjusted themselves. When they talk to poor people, they act like they're poor people. When they talk to rich people, they talk like rich people. When they talk to intellectuals, they come up with intellectual stuff. When they talk to simple folks from the villages, they talk like the village people. This adaptability in those human beings is remarkable. I've been watching this. I'm watching great master, how he was able to adjust himself to exactly who he was talking to. So this particular thing is of great importance, that how perfect living masters have to be human. Why did we have need to come physical experience? Because of the nature of consciousness. And we designed it so beautifully. It is not a necessity. It is not necessary to create a physical experience. You could create any other experience. No, we have created other experiences also. Physical is a very small experience. You go inside and see how many other experiences are available. We have created so many experiences, such a variety of them, unlimited experiences, all lying within your knowing by going within yourself. This is just one, not a bad one. If you treat it like an experience, not like my life. I am living a bad life. I am caught up in my karma. Karma was merely designed as a means of linking events together. Because this life was nothing more than events placed upon a timeline. Timeline was created first, events were thrown upon it, linked together, cause and effect. That's karma. There's nothing special about it, just a method of going through events. Life is nothing more than going through events and they get linked one cause and effect. When we add a dimension, a mental dimension called the moral dimension, we divide those events. It's an artificial division. But we divided good and bad. Actions, good and bad. The result, according to the law of cause and effect, good, you get rewarded. Bad, you get punished. Just a means of setting up a good drama. Had been set up very nicely. So sit inside on a comfortable chair and watch the drama. Don't get so involved in it. Any other questions? One more question.
Okay, I'm going to cheat one question and one note.
Okay.
We are aware of the spiritual ill effects of meat eating. What are the spiritual ill effects of womanizing? And to be politically correct, we should make the question, what are the spiritual ill effects of manizing as well? Then just a brief note for you before you answer that. I love you, but I do not know how to say this without using I. So love you and love you.
I'm glad you dropped the I and only said love you. We are aware of the spiritual ill effects of meat eating. What are the spiritual ill effects of womanizing? Whether it's meat eating or womanizing or stealing or robbing or murdering, we have defined what is good, what is bad. This definition is given by the mind, not by the soul. Soul has never divided anything, it's just experience. But the mind divides it in order to operate this law of karma with a moral basis of it. And therefore, we divide what is good and what is bad. And this good and bad is carried in our mind, not in our soul. Soul has no such thing as good and bad and a division at all. But when we use the mind to have experiences in this physical world, we divide them. It does not mean that the mind has divided into absolute divisions. This will be good always, this will be bad always. On the other hand, what is good in one country is bad in another. What is good at one time is bad at another time. What is good for one person is bad for another person. Therefore, it's all in the mind. And it has varied as we grow up in this experience from childhood, we grow up, most of these divisions are placed upon the mind and become part of our culture, part of our ethics, part of our growth through society, starting with parents, starting with relatives, siblings, and then with societies. They keep on telling us what is good and bad. Laws are enacted in different countries, different laws. They tell us this is punishable, this is rewardable. All these add up to create this division. And once the division is there, we have part of our mind, a little corner mind, we call it conscience. Not consciousness, conscience. The conscience says, if you do something wrong, I am disturbed. The mind says that. I am disturbed. Do good things. Don't do bad things. Rest of the mind says, bad thing look better. Conscience says, no. This debate is going on we say, I'll be a good person, and we do all bad things. People write to me, I am going to stop this thing. I am going to stop womanizing. I am going to stop smoking. I am going to stop stealing. I am going to stop the bad things. And then he writes after a month, I couldn't stop. Something is very strong in my mind. These are both operations of the mind. The conscience keeps a watch over our own moral standard that we have set. And the conscience says, that is not right. And we use the word sin. This is sinful. You are committing a sin. Conscience says sin. We say, oh, I want to commit sin. But little bit of that is all right. I went to a city called Las Vegas. I was told the name of the city is Sin City. I said, where am I getting into? I saw some nice shows. I found that you can gamble there, that you can have some entertainment there, but you can also commit sins. It's like any other city. The sin is not in the city. The sin is in the head. We forget this, that when the conscience hits the rest of our mind, the mental state, it creates this division. And therefore, it is a way in which we can operate the law of karma. The law of karma itself requires that we should divide these and divide our events into rewards and punishment. And therefore, we keep on having reward. We do good things, rewarded. Bad thing, we are punished. Some people started believing that if we do all good things, then we'll be able to go to heaven. It is true. You do all good things, you will go to heaven. Somebody said, who cares? Life is only one life. We can do anything, commit sin, then we die. Everybody dies. Who says we go to hell? That guy goes to hell. Where are these heavens and hells? They are in the astral plane. Astral plane, and you can all access it, by the way. Through meditation, you can go and see hells and heavens. And one great lady who was a BB in great master's time, out of curiosity, went into hell and cried so loudly. In the inner self, even body was crying. And we couldn't help her. We had to call great master. Said, where are you? She said, I've gone to hell. What made you go there? Curiosity. He said, why did you go alone? You should go with master if you want to explore anything after initiation. Are they hurting you? She said, no. Then why are you crying? I can't stand what torture they are doing to other people here. It's a very terrible punishment they are giving. I can't stand it. He says, why don't you repeat the 5 words I gave you? She says, I've forgotten them. In this great torture, I've forgotten my word. Great master said, we were watching this scene because she was my neighbor, our neighbor in the Dera. So, yes, I can hear your voice. Then follow my voice. And then she opened her eyes. And great master told us, others who were sitting there, you know, don't think that going to a level higher than this level is always pleasant. Hells and heavens are there. Good and bad is there. Positive and negative entities are there. So be careful. If you are initiated, first manifest the radiant form of the master inside. Go everywhere with the master. You will have no problem. It's a very good tip. I was careful. I asked you, be careful. So therefore, don't worry about this. So long as you are following the will of the master, nothing affects you. So long as our will is not in action, the mental will, we do not create a karma. neither good nor bad. To create a karma, we have to exercise a will, not simply a will, a deliberative will. That means we say, should I or should I not? And then you say, yes, I will do this. That creates good or bad karma. Karma is created not by an action. Karma is created by the decision, the intention to do something that's in the mind that you create karma. If you act upon that intention, it intensifies the effect of karma, intensifies the result. So the karma is not created all the time. People, somebody wrote to me yesterday. I was trying to drive very carefully, but a goose came in front of my car, I killed it. I am so sorry creating such a bad karma. Please forgive me. And please take care of the soul of the goose also. So, I wrote back that it was not your intention to kill the goose. If you look back, the goose killed you in a previous life. It was not a goose at that time. Maybe you are a goose. This is how law of karma is operating. So, because it was not your intention, you are forgiven completely. So far as the goose is concerned, I don't know how to take care of the goose. I have never dealt with geese. But I will ask great master to take care of it. Karma operates in a very funny way that it works with intention when you create. Those lives in which you can do it is called karmajuni. That means you can perform an action following intention that creates a karma. The only life is a human life that you can do it. Out of 8.4 million forms of life, only one life creates karma. All others are called bhogjuni. That means payoff of karma. We are paying off karma in every other form of life, including human life, but creation of karma takes place only here and not all the time. We are having so many accidental things happening around us, which is there's no intention involved, there's no karma being created, it's all payoff. Can you imagine the time we spend in actual clock time that we spend in creating karma is very little. But we create so much karma that we can be here for several lifetimes with one lifetime's karma. That is why this karma that we create, which we call karman karma, that means we created karma by us, karman karma leads to destinies of the future, including the past karma which created the destiny of this life. We call it the pralabdha karma. Pralabdha means destiny, already fixed, complete fixed, based upon previous lives. It does not mean previous one life. It can be previous 100 lives. Picked up little bit here, little bit there, and the life is constituted. It all has to be connected, event by event. So therefore, there is a soul who did good karma and took on the role of this work on a computer, how to design our life. In Indian text, they call him Dharmaraj, the angel of death. He is deciding when you die, what next life will you have. He looks back, oh, this karma can fit in one next life. And this is not enough to have the next life. Okay, the last life, let me look up. I used to be very surprised how busy that guy must be. I was also wondering what kind of computer he uses. Because I was saying, we beat thousands of people in a lifetime. And the guy has to work hard to reconnect thousands of people and put them all together once again. Not an easy job at all. But the understanding of reality came to me much later, when I discovered this job is very easy. There are no people. They are created for the pralabdha. He can create any people again or the pralabdha based upon previous people. and they are just projected from the mind inside. He is doing a very simple job, just setting up a life pattern, and the people come to be. Some new, some old, depending upon the karma of the past. He does not have to pick up any people from anywhere, which means our karma, our pralabdha, is unique and our own. All others are created for our pralabdha. This is very difficult to understand when we see the reality of separated beings. When we think we are all really completely separate, which we are not. It's the experience of one. The whole experience of life is experience of one. Supposing you were to go to sleep and have a dream. In the dream, 20 people come to see you. And you put them on a table to have some dinner or something. 20 of us. Somebody says, you know, it's a dream. One person in the dream, maybe you or somebody, says, do you know this is not real? This is a dream. When we wake up, we'll find out. Others say, doesn't look like a dream, looks real. I don't know why you are saying so. Well, I am saying so because I have some awareness that this is a dream. Okay, if it's a dream, who is dreaming? Are we 20 people dreaming? Who is dreaming? How are we 20 people here? You know, we know each other. How can we all 20 be present in the same dream? Then you wake up. Only one dreamer made the 20. But very interestingly, the 20 who were sitting on the table, 4 are sitting in your next room. They are living people. The remaining 16, we don't know where they are. Is there a difference between those 4 and the 16? 16 were created for the dream, 4 are living even in a higher state of wakefulness. Same thing happens here. When you wake up to the highest levels, you will discover that so many souls at that level also participate in the dreams or the creations at lower levels. But many of them are created just for the experience. Dharmaraj has no big problem in creating these people. And they look like all real. When we wake up, only some were real, some were not. The real ones disappear when we go higher. When we wake up, finally, there was only one dreamer, nobody else. All were the creation of the same dream. All were created from one totality of consciousness. As simple as that. Thank you very much for your patient listening again. Tomorrow is Bhandara. I'll be very happy to see you 11 o'clock again.